now beetle charger, to place a loaded rack of wagon and take out the empty wagon from the wagon tippler cradle. In hall and out hall, beetle chargers are used. Car puller, beetle charger and shakers is self-explanatory. The hall beetle, in hall beetle charger, it consists of a beetle charger, rope hauling winch, track and track gear. A beetle charger is a flat trolley mounted on the rollers and skid blocks. It moves on the auxiliary rail, which is placed in between and at lower elevation of the main track. The beetle has two pair of arms, which are automatically extended for in-haul and retract of the backhaul. The propelling arms are extended behind a wagon wheel, and restraining arms are in the front of wheel. Each propelling arm has two rollers, one for wagon wheel and another rest on the main track. A haulage is done by endless wire rope reeved around a drum or the winch. End of rope is connected with the sliding draw bar of the beetle. This draw bar during the haul keeps the propelling arm extended through a striker head, and end set of the mechanism and retraced during the reverse momentum, and the haulage winch is placed in a pit below the track. It comprises of electric motor, flexible coupling, reducing gearbox, output shaft, spur pinion engages with the spur rings bolted to the driving barrels of the haulage rope. Winch has thrusters operated brake, which is engaged normally but during the haulage automatically released. In limit switch synchronizes the moment of beetle and thereby controls the haulage moment. Track and track gear consist of rope tensioning unit, a wagon waiting and pickup area, head pulley unit, limit switch, a photo sail system, etc. to control the movement of beetle charger and thereby the wagon. Photoelectric unit consists of a projector unit, a photocell and receiver unit, that is a beam of light from projector unit falls on the lens of the receiver unit through a cell. If the light beam is interrupted by any construction, then the circuit in the receiver unit will close and will not allow the wagon tippler to take a start. And now the beetle charger track is laid down into the ambush pit so that at the end of a backhaul, the charger is taken below the level of main track rails and locomotive with the clearance can pass over it. Now the operating procedure for in-haul beetle charger. The operation of in-haul beetle charger should be done in the following sequence. Press the reverse push button so that it can return to ambush pit and thereby clear the track of the locomotive. Assist the locomotive to bring in and place the rack of wagons correctly on the in-haul track. Uncouple the rack of wagons and signal the driver to take out the remaining wagons. Now press forward push button of the in-haul beetle charger and beetle charger will move the rake of wagon forward until the first wagon comes in a weighing position where it will stop automatically. Now uncouple the first wagon from the rake and place the wagon centrally on the tippler plant platform from so that it will be not obstruct the photocell path. Now press the battle ready, push on and observe the light, that is a control transfer on. When the beetle charger returns from the tippler platform, control transfer light will go off. Now actuator energizes, then starts the wagon tipplers to rise. After the unloading of wagon tippler reverses and comes to original position. Now push the in-haul beetle forward so that the next wagon of the rack moves forward and pushes out the empty wagon out of the track. and repeat the above operation until the wagons are unloaded. Now outhaul beetle chargers. Its construction is almost similar to in-haul beetle chargers. It has one pair of arms to drag the empty wagon on the overall track. It has also having a forward and reverse push button. It moves the empty wagon forward by length of one wagon. After the doing this, it will return to the ambush pit and will repeat the same operation as each wagon is discharged from tippler platform. The empty wagon kept beyond the end of the overhaul track will be removed by the locomotive. Now the transfer system of coal. Transfer system of coal from unloading hopper to the coal mill bunker. That is, if we follow the path of the coal after it is tripped from the wagons, we find that it falls through a chorus grills installed to stop the bulky objects from getting into the conveyor system and doing the damage into the hopper. At the bottom of the hopper is an opening running a full length of the hopper and covered by the continuous line of flap doors suspended by the hinges. These doors retain the coal in the hopper while it is being discharged from the wagons. They are open while the feeding coal from the hopper to the conveyors running lengthwise along each side of the hopper and carrying this coal to the crusher house. Now crushed coal can be fed either to boiler bunkers of each unit called a raw coal bunkers, or it can be stacked in the stockyard depending upon the situations. It is preferable to feed as much coal as possible directly to the raw coal bunkers in a order to reduce the double handling. To transfer the coal from track hopper house to the raw coal bunker, the following equipment and machines are used. First is a apron blade or vibration feeders. First, apron feeder. It is installed at the bottom of the coal unloading hopper for feeding the coal uniformly to the conveyor belt running underneath and all along the length of the hopper. Apron feeder consists of a tractor type chain driven by the motor, which helps in feeding the coal. Second is a blade feeder. The blade feeder has four blades driven by motor. The edges of these blades form a circle which drives the coal from feeding to the conveyor belt. There is a separate arrangement for complete shifting of blade housing so that complete unloading hopper is emptied out. Usually a two separate blade feeders are installed over each belt. The feeders can be adjusted for feeding the coal at different speeds as per the requirements. The feeder blades have the edges of wear resistance material like a nickel chromium steel, which can be replaced easily. Suitable locks are fastened onto the travel rails to operate the reverse or forward switches on the travel carriage so that the feeder can operate on any part of the hopper. Third, vibrating feeders. These are the vibrating or jiggling type and placed immediately below the coal receiving hopper. The feeders are designed to take coal from the hopper and deliver it to the corresponding conveyors without spilling. Juggling feeders give the trays an oscillating motion through a connecting rod via variable stroke and crank arm reduction gear and motor. The vibrating feeders give the tray vibrations caused by the use of electromagnets, electrical impulses, and a pass through a stator and coils, forming the magnetic circuit to create a sequence of interrupted magnetic pulses on the armature, which is connected to the vibrating bars through a center clamp. The length of the strokes or the amplitude of vibration is infinitely variable even while the machine is running up to the 1/32% for the AC and 1/16 inch for DC. The length of stroke of vibration is controlled by increasing or decreasing the current input, which in turn regulates the strength of the pull of electromagnet. So these are the vibrating fields. Conveyor belts. Conveyor belt is a basic equipment in any material handling plant. Smooth and trouble-free operation of this equipment will go a long way in efficient operation and the entire plant. Conveyor belt is used in a coal handling plant to convey the coal from one transfer point to another. The belt, which is supported and moves on the idlers or individual rollers with the anti-friction bearings, carries a coal horizontally or on an incline up or down. The drive pulley is usually at the head end, sometimes at the tail end, and in few cases it at the intermediate point on the return side of the belt. The coal is discharged over the head or at any point over a carrying side. Number of conveyor belt stages are used before the coal is fed to the boiler bunkers. Now, the various parts and equipments required for conveyor belt system are as follows: belts, idlers, pulleys, driving unit, belt cleaners, framework, stringers, stands, decking plant, galleries, walkway, trestles, belt coverings, hoods, chutes, gates and skirts, and take-up. Apart from these parts and equipments, following accessories are also required for successful running of a conveyor belt. That is pull wire switches, belt sway switches, zero speed switches, de-interlocking switches, flap limit switches, magnetic pulleys, suspension type electromagnet, mouthpieces and isolating gates. Also, the belt weighing machines. Description of some important parts and accessories is given below. Parts and equipments of a conveyor belt system. First is a belt. The size and type of belt to be used is decided as per the material size and quantity to be transported. Generally, the two types of belts are used. One is a PVC and another is a rubber belt. The PVC belt is not considered suitable for the surface installation continuously exposed to the sunlight, which have the deteriorating effect on the belt cover. Conveyor belts consist of essentially of layers of fabric impregnated with a rubber compound and the protective cover of abrasion resistance rubber. The fabric may be a cotton or nylon. This rubber belt used for coal conveyors have number of suitable skin coated pails of the fabric, and rubber fabric compounds in the finished belt are vulcanized at a high temperature and pressure. The rubber covers reinforcement on all sides and protects it against abrasion and humidity and chemicals. The reinforcement consists of fabric textile piles, sometimes called ducts, gives it a necessary strength and carrying capacity. The basic requirements for belt are: first is a good tensile strength, second is a good elasticity, third one is a low permanent elongation, fourth one is a high bending resistance, fifth one is a sufficient weight strength, and fifth one is a favorable cost. For installation, a conveyor belt roll brought to site and the belting pulled on the conveyor idlers after suitable fastening at the end of the ensures that carrying side, which is generally a branded side, this right side up, and then the belt is cut about 1% less in the length than the minimum tape line measurement around the pulleys. Both ends are joined either by vulcanizing or by filament of fasteners, and initial tension in the rubber belt runs from 15 to 25 lbs per ply per inch, and maximum safe tight side tension of rubber belts are given as tension is 25 when the duct weight is 28, and the ultimate tensile strength of rubber belt varies from 280 to 500 lbs or more per inch width per ply. Now, specification of grade B of being supplied by the Dunlop or a Goodyear is given below. Capacity of 750 to 825 tons per hour. Now, belt width is 1200 mm. Inclination angle is 15 or 18 degrees. Total lift of 30 meters. Number of piles is 5 to 7 numbers. Duct weight is 1360 grams. Weight of the belt is 17 to 20 kg per meter. Top cover thickness is 2.5 to 5 mm. Now the bottom cover thickness is 2 mm. Piles are scheme coated. The allowable tension is 8.75 tons. Now belt speed varies with 160 to 175 meters per minute. And belt material is a cotton, duck rubber, covered and toughened. Idlers. Idlers are required for supporting and carrying the conveyor belt. These consist of a steel tube trogging idlers, rubber disc impact idlers, and return idlers fitted with the anti-friction taper roller bearings and the sealing arrangement in a cast iron housing. The anti-friction taper roller bearing provides a smooth roll operation with the minimum effort. The bearings are protected from the outer side by multi-layer seal and which prevents the ingress of dust. The idlers should be high capacity and heavy duty, suitable for continuous operation and meant for longer life of the belt. A flat belt carrying a large quantity of the coal and operating at the velocities up to 175 meters per minute would not be practicable because the coal would spill over the edges of the belt and consequently make more work for the plant attendant. For this reason, the troving idlers are used on carrying side of the belt in which the belt rests on the angled rollers and forms a trough to carry the coal. Depicts the three roll troughing idler. Rolls are mounted on the brackets which are fixed on the idler base frame, and side rollers have an inclination of varying from 20 to 45 degrees towards the horizontal. More the angle of inclination, more is the coal carrying capacity of the belt, which has less spillage. But pure cotton can no longer be used in higher inclination as it lacks the necessary bending resistance. Nylon can, however, be used, which provides a necessary fiber elongation in the corners where the side rollers meet the horizontal rollers, and the side rollers have also tilting angle of about 3 degrees in the direction of belt travel. This angle helps the belt to run through to center. This tilting angle should be provided only for the belt conveyors, which run always in one direction. No tilt should be provided for reversible belts because the belt tilt in the opposite direction of the belt travel is liable to wear the bottom belt cover off, which is a very thin. The traveling belt hits the horizontal roller first and then the side roller. The various idlers employed in the most of the power station of our country consist essentially of the roll made out of the seamless steel tube enclosed by a pulley heads at each end and fitted with the stationary shaft. The rubber disc impact idlers are a type of a soft rubber and these are used to absorb the heavy impacts at the transfer points where the coal falls from the height on the conveyor belt. In some other special applications, the idler's rolls are rubber-lagged, and in order to prevent the buildup of material, since the resilience surface causes a material to crack and fall off, the rubber disc impact idler is shown in figure. The return idler supports the belt on its reverse travel. Normally, these are solid horizontal rollers. The return idler brackets are designed to provide a maximum clearance to the belt, and these are directly mounted on the conveyor strings, and the pulley roll is supported in the brackets. It is important for the true running of the belt that the return rollers should be set carefully at right angles to the center line of the length of the belt. Self-aligning or carrying the return idlers are also used in generally placed at 15 meters from each terminal of bend pulley and approximately 24 meters thereafter. These idlers swing around a vertical center line of a central pivot and thereby facilitate the central running of the belt. The carrying trainers used are positive action type, automatically train the belts and protect belt's edges from injury caused by the